the more opportunities are presented to you by your organization, you should be happy it is. You get a chance to, you know, learn and grow as a leader. Now, this again brings us to the point of how we can grow as a leader. I have taken up a few points here, which I think can help a person grow as a leader. I'm not going by the various books that are written and how they tell us about the leadership traits and how to develop them, because I feel they are quite at tactical level in terms of lot of information. What I am trying to share with you here is some few concepts here, the basic concepts. Now, how you actually do it, I give you some pointers, but ultimately it is about in terms of its mental capacities. So I will share three areas here what I feel a person can do, and for what tools and what techniques I have in mind, I'll share with you. So one of the things that we saw in the great leaders was they had a passion for the outcome. And they could work with a lot of endurance about what we do. We should love to do what we are doing. So if that is not the case, then we have to revisit that. So we will revisit how the point that I have to share with you is capacity and demonstrate higher values and improve decision making. And the third point to focus, how we can demonstrate the agility. So now we'll go to the work. Here I have taken one scenario. How I can choose my work. Now if you see in this scenario, the basic premise was to identify the available income opportunity. So when we are beginning our careers in our country here, there's quite a lot of the insecurity, the parents, the environment. We are constrained for resources. There is poverty in our country. We have seen so many movies on this subject, like The Three Idiots and other movies, where the people want their children to become engineers or doctors or whatever. From there, they can actually live a good life. So, many a times, many of us have started with this as a basic premise, that we identify the available income opportunities or what career we should pursue, then we develop the skills according to that, and then we work for that money, for the money that is available to that profession. But if you look at this pyramid, this kind of development that we do for ourselves, with a period of time, our satisfaction would drop, because as per the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, it may make some money and it may fulfill your physiological needs and other needs, and to some extent your cognitive needs. But if it is not the area that you really wanted to work in, you know. So I know what I love. So if I'm a singer, a dancer, musician, analytical person, maybe a creative person, maybe a research oriented person, then I pursue those and see how my passion can help, and ultimately I discover what I can do for the people and how I can feel happy about that. So I start serving with skill and passion. Now as you start serving with skill and passion, again we'll go to the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and if you see that not only we have achieved the physiological needs, we have moved up the cognitive needs are also getting met, because as you do the work more passionately, you get more recognition. Maybe you are happy that what you are doing, it satisfies your cognitive needs, and then you move further to a self-actualized state. Even the today's Maslow's hierarchy of needs has been further modified. I think it is said that it has come up with a model which came up later, where he even talks about transcendence. So I'm not going to the details of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, but to give you an idea that if you start with the premise of what I love to do and figure out a good match for and a good good opportunity for you, which uses your skill and your passion, then the chances of you being satisfied with the work and maintaining the passion in the work that you do is higher. Otherwise, to say that you become passionate about what you're doing is not going to happen, right? So if the project, if you as a leader, if you're expected to be passionate, what are we passionate about? The cause is passionate or the achievement is passionate, what are we passionate about? And how we can maintain ourselves in that frame of enthusiastic frame of mind? Well, unless we are enthusiastic, how are we going to inspire people? That is the question. Because there will be issues, there will be difficulties, but the passion is, they keep moving on. They are always in a positive frame of mind. Even in a situation where 50 runs is required of 15 balls, the person goes for the winner. Sometimes in the last, you have seen in the T20 matches, in the 12 runs, 12 balls, 24 runs are also got, or 30 runs are also been available. Last 3 balls go for 14 runs, 4, 4, 6. Now these are unimaginable situations, and unless the person is very passionate about what he does and has a state of mind that he can, you know, still achieve the objective, it is not going to happen. So how do we find the sweet spot as a professional? Now we are looking at the competence, we are looking at the passion, we are looking at the money. Now an area of work that we are passionate about, where we have developed certain skills and we are getting financially compensated, that we do fit into this criteria, then we can be passionate professionals and we can definitely deliver on the project results. I'm not saying that you are not delivering on the project results. You may be already delivering on the project results. But the question that we are asking ourselves is how we can grow as a leader. So as a leader, you can do things more effortlessly. So even if you're achieving today, there may be certain effort, there may be some strain, there may be some stress. Now, how a person who's passionate does not get so tired. He doesn't feel tired because he is so much involved in the work. They can work for longer hours without getting tired and without harming the body. Some people might be able to work for longer duration, but they might be harming the body through the stress that they create for themselves. So it's a question of finding the sweet spot as a professional. Now, how do I find the sweet spot as a leader? Now, as far as a leader is concerned, we already talked about self-actualization. We just don't look at the competence, but we start looking at the character of the person as well, because you build a trust. Now, Mahatma Gandhi had to build a trust with the people through his fasting, his satyagrahas. It was not just passion. He had a lot of trust. The people had a lot of trust. He would say something and just people would follow him. It was the power of his trust that he had built with the people. There's a sense of purpose. The purpose was not the only his own purpose. The purpose was a shared purpose. The purpose for which he was fighting was a larger purpose. So he could connect to the people. So as a leader, if we have passion, we have the people that we have, we are leading. And if you have a large purpose, which is a mentor. Now I talked about doing the right things. Now what do you mean by doing the right things? We all know that there are certain things which we do and we feel happy about doing it. In the modern world, there is a lot of dishonesty around, but normally, it's that more as our morals are concerned, we tell our children to be honest, to be truthful. So, if you can do things truthfully, just do things by lying, then what happens? The person does not feel very happy inside. So, there are values dear to each individual. So, there are some sample values which I've depicted here. There could be more values also, but these are values in different areas that we could pick from. Now, what is the effect of the value system on behavior? Now, if you look at these values, they are the fundamental things by which we work. Suppose there's a value of discipline, we value discipline, or we value punctuality, or we say we have to be honest, or we have to be truthful. Now, these are the various values that a person may say, these are important to me. If they are not met, I cannot perform in that organization, or I cannot work with such people. So these are our decision-making process. Now there's a situation where some of the value that you hold dear to yourself is not met by some individual, or is that which doesn't your value system or the organizational values respond to the situations. And similarly, there could be rules associated with those values. Now, for example, in our country, we have something about the time. We have you see more is expected to be punctual time 30. So we already created the flexibility with our expectation management. So this is how the rules associated with the time can affect the team dynamics. So how in a particular team we behave, what is our reaction, what we value, what others value. So having a shared value system, a common value system, definitely will make the environment better to work as a team. But as leaders, we have to work with teams that whatever the value system is available to us, and depend and what is our value system will be always there will be some kind of a gap between what we hold dear and what the team as a whole will present itself as. Now this kind of things will affect our response. So if being mindful of that and being mindful of our perceptions, there's an opportunity for us to improve our value system as well, because there are certain values which we have ingrained in ourselves over a period of time. So in certain areas, we are not talking about changing the value system of others. The important thing here for us to understand is how we can improve certain values which are excellent and we admire them. So let's say we are working with a Westerner and who has a punctuality time, he's very punctual. So instead of looking at the team members who are not punctual, we can try and become punctual. So this is what I am trying to bring out here, to align to the better value, not align to our own value, not expecting people to align to my objective to achieving the project outcome. Now it is sometimes easier said than done. You know, sometimes you understand at the intellectual level, okay, this is what needs to be done, but when the situation comes, the tendency is not to be able to do that. We are running a bit out of time, but I need another 5 minutes to complete, I think. I'll just quickly do this. Demonstrating change in behavior through awareness change. There is an exercise stage and the action stage. In the exercise stage, if you want to build up our awareness, emotional awareness, we can look at our body awareness, sense awareness, breath awareness, thought awareness, emotional awareness, mindfulness, and transcendence. Now these are the various stages of our self-awareness. Now this is can be done quietly sitting at one place. You can look at all, you can be aware of your body, senses, breath, thoughts, emotions. So in a peaceful state, this is the exercise that you can do. You can spend some time with yourself, close your eyes and do that. Yeah, either if you know, already know meditation, you could do some kind of a meditation and understand yourself. But in the action stage, there's no time to just meditate. Action is where you have to respond to situations. What happens in that situation? Let us look at that. This state, our values are not states. We are in a not in the most empowering states. We are in a, we can be in a negative emotions. Now how we can move towards self-awareness? That is the key here. Now one towards self, a temporary dip in our emotional awareness, where we are getting frustrated or we are getting, you know, kind of depressed with the situation, or we are getting angry with the situation. How we can quickly come back to an empowering state? Look at the focus. What is our focus? What are we trying to achieve here? What is our goal here? Revalidate our options and respond. Now this set looks easier than done. So there's where the exercise is important. Like we do physical exercise, so the exercise helps us when we actually want to do stressful tasks which are physically stressful. So similarly, if we want to be mentally tough, we have to do certain exercises which help us be mentally more stable and more resilient. And in situation, demanding situation, we can perform better. If you want to be cool and calm like Dhoni, then we'll have to do something about it. Some Dhoni may be natural at that, but all people may not be natural. So we'll have to learn to be in that state of mind. Now, as a decision maker, we have looked at the I part here, where the contextual information, our intentions, the values, the rules and beliefs and the perception that we carry influence our decision making. Once we learn the awareness part of it, that we, how we can come to the empowering states more often, then we get a chance to recognize the alternatives here. The alternatives that come through us to intuitiveness, through the diversity in the team, the people in the team. We can be good listeners. We can get alternatives from them. We can go deep into ourselves through our imagination. We can come up, choose the right values. Again, the free will is very important here. The will to change the pattern. Because this I that we have developed over a period of time is habitual, is a pattern that we have developed. So if we want to change or we want to grow, we have to change the pattern to more productive patterns. And to do that, we need to be aware. And not only do we have to be aware, we have to be able to have the will to choose the options which come from elsewhere, maybe through diversity, through intuitiveness, through imagination, and they are having the values that can benefit the maximum stakeholders. It should not be a selfish motive. The motive here has to be a higher purpose, and then we can grow in our decision making and the mental capacity. The last point that I have to share with you here is the agility. Now, agility is the buzzword today. We are talking about being agile, program management, project management. But when I talk about agility, I'm focusing here on the adaptive mindset. If we take the wave, if you're using a surfer, the surfer is already changing, and the surfer has to be always alert. He has to focus on his results here. He has to surf the wave and reach the this is what will keep changing, but we have to surf the wave and we have to have adaptive mindset. Now, the agile as a methodology is more coming from the adaptive process. But the key thing here is first you have to have an adaptive mindset, then you should be able to adapt the process, whether it's a waterfall model or the iterative development model. And we already discussed about this, the cultural beliefs that you have, the teams, the organizational belief system that people have. So we have having people with diversity, we have to lead them, the situation, and together I'm putting as a agility, something that basically comes from the adaptive mindset. Once you have the adaptive minds, you can develop these other attributes which are going to make you an agile performer. To summarize, PM is both a leader and a manager. We can imbibe values from leaders we admire and choose as our role models. We can learn from both success and failures. We can grow as leaders by being passionate in our work, increase in mental capacity, and demonstrating agility. This is a conference that our chapter is coming up with in the month of December. The theme of the conference is delivering business